Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Thakur Rajaram. I am working as an assistant professor in the St. Martin's Engineering College. Today in this session, we will discuss about the topic photoelectric effect. So what is basically photoelectric effect is? So before going to discuss what is photoelectric effect, we need to know the light has dual nature. So that is particle nature and wave nature of light. So in case of wave nature, we can define the wave nature of light as the wave consists of frequency, wavelength, amplitude, and it can also contain some phase and velocities. Those are group velocities, otherwise you can say phase velocities. We can define the wave light, the disturbance, or the wave can transmit the energy from one point to another point. So we can say that a wave is nothing but a form of energy which can by using this wave we can transmit the energy from one point to another point. In case of particle, we can define a particle as it is a localized space particle. We can say that the particle will have some location. So in case of wave, there is no location for a wave. Wave can be spread out. So this is a pattern in which we are having some disturbance. So we cannot say that the wave is at particular point, the wave is here or there. So we cannot say that the wave is having a localized space. In case of particle, we are having a particle, so then we can say that the particle is here. So it is having some location also, and particle can have momentum, which is indicated by v. It can have velocity, it can have mass, it can have energy. So all these things the particle may have. So now let us discuss the photoelectric effect. So what is photoelectric effect first? So whenever the light of suitable frequency falls on a metal surface, so let us consider a HQ of energy photon, which is of red color frequency, is falling on the or incidenting on a metal surface. Let us consider this metal surface as a emitter or a metal simply. So whenever we incident the red color light, then if this material is having the sufficient energy, then it ejects the electrons from this metal surface. If this material is not depending, if this material not having sufficient energy which is provided by this red color frequency, then this metal surface cannot eject the electrons. So let us consider another metal surface in which we are incidenting a blue color frequency on this surface, so that this material is, this frequency is sufficient for this particular metal, then it ejects some of the electrons from this metal surface. So that the if this frequency is a threshold frequency, that can be nothing but the at that particular frequency the emission of the photo electrons, or simply you can say electrons or photo electrons, the electrons are ejected from this metal surface. So if there is no energy, or if there is a frequency which is less than this minimum frequency, then there is no ejection of electron takes place from this metal surface. So for that experimental arrangement, we will consider a metal surface, that is, let us say this is emitter here, and we are incidenting some blue color wavelength on this particular or blue color frequency on this emitter, and we are having another metal surface, that is, let us say it is a collector. So what is the use of emitter here is, whenever light incidents on this metal surface, then the emitter will eject the electrons from this metal surface. So the electrons may move in any of the directions. So some of them may have some kinetic energy that is sufficient to go up to the collector. Then there may be, this circuit is complete, then we can say that there is some current flow happens in this particular circuit. So the galvanometer is used to detect whatever the electrons are coming into the collector region, and there is if this circuit is complete, then there is a flow of current happens in this particular circuit. Let us consider a battery here. So this battery polarity can be changed. So we are having a variable voltage battery here. Let us say firstly we are taking positive terminal here and negative terminal for the emitter and positive terminal for the collector. So what is the use of battery here? because some electrons may not go towards the collector region, they may go in any other direction. So to take more number of electrons towards the collector region or to collect more number of electrons towards the collector region, we are connecting the battery here, and we are giving some positive potential to here to get more number of electrons towards the collector region. Now we need to know that the difference between if there is no battery here, even if then also there is some flow of current here, because the motion of electrons carries the current. So that we can say that even if without the battery here, there is some flow of current happens. Now if we increase the positive potential, that means more number of electrons will come towards the collector region and more current will be flowed through the circuit. Now we need to see the relationship between the voltage and photoelectric current. So the photoelectric current and stopping potential relation, we are drawing a graph between these two. So let us consider the voltage along the x-axis and photoelectric current along the y-axis. So as we increase the positive potential, the current reaches to the current will increase first, and then at a particular positive potential, which is the maximum positive potential, the current reaches to a saturation value here, that is the maximum value of current. If again further you increase the voltage, there is no change in current because the current reaches to a saturation value. So we can say that there is no increase in current even if you increase the voltage. Now if we increase the negative potential here, if we increase the negative potential, then what happens is the current reaches to a zero value at a particular voltage value. So that value is nothing but the stopping potential value. Now we need to consider the graph between the intensity of light and current. We need to know the graph between the intensity of light and current. So if we increase the intensity of light, then the current also increases. If we are having a sufficient color of wavelength or sufficient frequency, that is minimum frequency, that should be above the threshold frequency. If we increase the intensity of light, then the current also reaches. There is a linear relationship between the intensity of light and photoelectric current. Now if we draw a graph between the photoelectric current and the stopping potential, let us say, then if we increase the intensity, let us say in first case we are having intensity I1, in the second case we are having intensity I2, that means we are increasing the intensity. In this case we are having intensity, that is I1, and in this case the intensity is increased to double or twice. Now we are increasing the intensity twice, so we can write here I3. So even if we increase the intensity, the stopping potential value will not change for any of these intensities, so that the stopping potential value is constant. So the stopping potential value for the photoelectric current is V0, that is a constant value. So that next thing we will see the relationship between the frequency and stopping potential. So the frequency is along x-axis and the stopping potential we take along the y-axis. Now we see that below the minimum frequency, there is no emission of electrons takes place. Even if you increase the intensity much higher, but there is no emission of electron takes place. So at this particular frequency, the emission of electron starts and it is a linear one. So as we increase the intensity, the stopping potential value also increases. This stopping potential value is different for different materials, and the threshold frequency value is also different for different materials. So let us consider for example purpose, let us consider this is a potassium element threshold frequency value. Next, in second case we can say that this is for sodium metal, and in the third case we can take tungsten, and in the fourth case we can take the example of platinum. So as you see that the slope of these may be nearly same, but the frequencies they are different. So the stopping on the threshold frequency for potassium metal is B0, which is here, starting here, and for the sodium metal, it is starting from here. So the emission of electrons takes place at different potentials as well as the different threshold values. So if we apply the classical theory of light, that will fail to explain the photoelectric effect. Why it fails? Let us see that. So let us examine about the classical theory of light to explain the photoelectric effect. So firstly, if we are considering that our light is as a wave, then if we increase the intensity, then the emission of electrons should be increased. So firstly, let us consider that two variables, intensity and frequency. Firstly, we are increasing the intensity of light and keeping the frequency as constant. In the next case, we will increase the frequency and see what happens in the next case. So our frequency here is constant. So let us consider some red color frequency firstly, then the light comes here and hits the photometal surface, then it will shake the atom firstly, then if it has sufficient frequency, it absorbs that frequency and the emission of photoelectrons takes place. So there should be a direct interaction between, if in this case there is no direct interaction between the atom and photon. So if we take the particle nature, there is a direct interaction, that's why the electrons are getting emitted from the photometal surface. So in this case, if we consider another example for this particular thing, if we increase the intensity, so let us consider a tree in a sea which is having some fruits on it. So if amplitude of the wave is less, then if it hits to the tree, then no fruits will fall down. If we are increasing the amplitude of the wavelength, then also there is no emission of, or there is no fall down of these fruits from the tree. So if we take the classical theory here, that means there is no use of the classical theory here. Why? Because there is no direct interaction happening in case of classical theory of light. Now if we consider the photo particle theory of light, which was proposed by Albert Einstein, particles theory, what he has assumed is, let us say firstly, Planck hasn't applied the statistical theory towards his equation, that is E equals to h nu. So in case of kinetic theory of gases, we know that a container consists of finite number of particles. So we will get number of particles here, finite number of particles. So in case of here, we can write n number of particles, and in Planck's theory, we are getting some total energy divided by h nu. So in these two cases, Einstein observed a relation, mathematical similarity actually it is. So here we are getting some number and here also we are getting some number. He thought that light may not be like a wave, it may be like a particle. So we are getting a number here and we are also getting a number here. So he assumed that light is like a particles which are traveling. So he proposed his particle theory of light by saying that light is a train of particles which are traveling. And he said that the energy, exchange of energy, and we can say that the Planck wasn't sure that the exchange of energy taking place in terms of chunks or in terms of the quantized energies. He was not sure about this formula, but he was knew that the energy can be exchanged according to this formula. What Einstein has told is, the energy exchange is happening because of this formula, because every photon is consisting of this particular energy. We can say that here we can have a h nu of energy for one photon, any photon. We can say another photon also can have the same energy. So the dependency of frequency here, if the frequency is more then the energy is also more, if frequency is less then the energy may be less. So he has proposed the particle theory. He is saying that light is a train of particles which are traveling, and now we can say that secondly the photon carries a momentum. We can write E equals to h nu and E equals to hc by lambda. So here we can write for momentum P equals to we can write here E equals to h by lambda is nothing but the momentum, that is P equals to h by lambda, and we can write it here PC, so that we can write P equals to E by C. So we can write here P equals to h nu by C, and this h nu by C is nothing but h by lambda. So we can say that a particle consisting of momentum and the wave contains wavelength. So here we can say that there is a duality of particle as well as wavelength. Wave particle duality, this particular equation shows the wave particle duality. Now we can say that the rest mass of the photons is zero, but even if it is having less rest mass zero, but it carries some momentum, because this momentum is because of this energy. So the momentum of the photon is due to the energy of the photons. So that's it all for this session, and thank you.